All right. Okay. Well, welcome. Welcome one and all, Prog Socialites, to this the 2012 AGM. Yeah, I'd like to open this meeting, as is the tradition, by acknowledging the Gadigal people of the Eora Nation, upon which, you know, this meeting is being held tonight on their traditional lands. And as usual, we have to start with administrivia, the apologies. And these people, Andrew, Margaret, and Noah, send their apologies. And as you can see, they've also nominated proxies in the event of an election tonight. And administrivia point number two, we have to look at the minutes of the last year's AGM to verify their correctness. Yes, 22 people met, so I'm just going to scroll through that. If anyone has any issues, please bring them up. Very slowly.
I saw something about Belgian beer cafe down there.
Yeah.
Very important. What happened to it?
It happened?
Yes.
I believe so.
No one died?
Yeah. No one died, yeah.
And yes, there was the vote on the Constitution last year. Remember that? That was heaven.
It's changed from Tom's rule of life.
Yeah. The elections, vice president, secretary, treasurer, CSO, alumni rep. Yet that no longer applies, the UAP ECC, because we're all in the union now. The SSAF has been introduced, so yeah.
SSAF?
It's sort of a compromise between the old union thing.
Right.
Remember, it's not quite VSU, it's not quite CSU.
Right.
Anyway. Signatories, general business. We didn't get to do much general business.
That's because we talked too long at the start.
Yeah. Hopefully we have plenty more to talk about.
Leather-bound DFM?
Sorry?
Did
I say leather-bound
DFM?
Yeah, that's a bit questionable.
Okay.
No.
Minutes look good.
Minutes look good.
Second that.
Approve. Mm. Okay, well, point number three, the executive report. By president. Me. Yeah, no, well, it's been, I like to think, I like to call it a platinum year in ProgSoc history. Not a golden year, I wanted to deliver a platinum year. I believe, you know, I and my six loyal members of the executive did that. We did, did four talks and, you know, three fun activities. Started off the year with the first year talk. That's something for the, you know, programming fundamental students. That was, I like to keep that as a tradition. I like to do that every year. So plan to do that very soon. And then shortly after that, thanks to some contact from IBM, DCOM here, we did a talk on IPv6. That was reasonably well attended, about 30-odd people. Or thereabouts. That seems about right, yeah.
Fill
the room, we did. And it was very fascinating, very eye-opening. Yeah, and then, of course, at the end of that semester was laser tag. That was lots of fun. Laser tag over at M9 in Darling Harbour. Yeah. And then we...
Not in the tower.
Sorry?
Not in the tower.
Not in the tower, no, unfortunately not.
Because that would be awesome.
Yes. Suggested activities later on. And then we came back second semester. Second semester we did... That's right, we did ThoughtWorks. We had a little agile activity with ThoughtWorks. We actually did something in 2010 with them as well. It was a nice little talk. This was a more hands-on. It was a kind of fun activity. It was playing with Lego. So we're learning about the agile method by playing with Legos. It was lots of fun. There was no coding, but we learned so much, didn't we? Yeah, and Livia, you gave me a hard time. Yeah. And then shortly after that, we went and did... Yeah, what did we do? We also did... we had our 22nd boy 222 anniversary.
How was that celebrated?
We went to Cockatoo Island. Remember that? You were there and Deacon was there and...
you took lots of photos.
You took lots of photos. Yeah, it was a lovely day. It was like a beautiful winter's day in Sydney. perfect day, and it's yeah, for a yeah, auspicious occasion. And
anything before the security talk by Deacon?
Which leads to the security talk given by Deacon. He's really, really come strong for us this year. He's really delivered, you know, the first talk of the year, and then more or less, and then this time he did a talk on internet security and you. And it was very entertaining, and I believe the video is finally up.
It's been up for hours already.
For hours.
Hours and hours.
Hours. I mean,
it's like days on each.
I know.
So, yeah, it's on YouTube, right?
Yeah.
Go on YouTube. Have a look at it.
I have super privileges giving me the link to upload 2 hours of none of that 15-minute
stuff. Yeah. Yeah, that was very worthwhile, worth seeing, yeah. And basically, I was a bumbling fool, just like I am right now. Introducing him. And yeah, we wrapped up the year with Christmas party at the Star. We went to formerly known as Star City. We didn't do much gambling, so but we did drink a little and we did some more laser tag.
In the Star. You can do laser tag in the Star.
No, they wouldn't allow it, probably OHS issues.
It's a redefinition of the term non-owned bandit.
Yeah, so that pretty much that we did quite a fair bit. In addition to our weekly meetings that we have every Thursday in Building 10 in this building, over in the other room over there, 5 o'clock the door is open. You should come every week. You know, we're still doing that. But yeah, no, it was quite busy. And
how was O-Day?
Which leads to O-Day. Yeah, I guess O-Day. 18. New sign-ups, 11 new sign-ups and 18 renewals, or was it the other way around? I can't remember exactly, but we got about 30 people, 30 members, right? And yeah, I actually showed them a copy of this as well. Right, it's a draft, we'll talk about that later on. That was pretty good, and obviously...
And what's the membership this year compared to 12 months ago? What's the numbers?
Well, I mean, if Kristina could consult her sheet, I mean, she could tell me how many people we've got so far.
Okay.
Yeah. We ended last year with 90 members. And that's also partly due to another little initiative that I introduced, and that is locking of accounts. It's actually a long-standing ProgSoc policy, but it's been pretty lax, you know. Or no one
used to love the tradition it's not to.
Yes. No, but we have a policy here, you know, front page, you know, account locking policy, which we don't follow, but, you know, we do have one, so...
So when were the accounts locked?
They were locked in May, I mean, straight after, I mean, I gave a month's grace after the AGM, right, and we locked them in May, but this year they will lock on April the 2nd at 11 a.m, because I used the shadow expire to do that.
Yes. Historically speaking, that's quite a big deal.
Yeah.
Because that never got done.
Yeah, no one knew how to play with LDAP. LDAP is this big, scary thing that no one wants to touch, you know. But I braved it and, yeah.
Account locking
was
done a few years ago. We were going to roll out the system.
Yeah.
We wouldn't lock much,
glorious achievements.
Yeah. No, but it has been a real privilege, though. Real privilege serving as your president. I'd be deeply honoured if you vote me again, you know. Sorry? That's not part of the speech. That wasn't part of the speech. That was a personal remark. Off the record.
The chairman abusing his position.
Yeah, really. You have to stand down before you ask to be re...
Okay.
Off the record with a dirty great microphone.
Yeah.
How do you feel? So we've obviously got notes of last year's AGM and stuff we want to do last year. Do you feel that we delivered on all that stuff, or?
We rarely do, but I mean, we did some things. No, you know how it is. We come up with so many ideas. I mean, one thing I'd earnestly like to see is we come up with many great ideas and actually implement them this year. That would be pretty awesome.
Partially completed. TFM.
Yeah, that the TFM report that will come later in the agenda. Well, okay, I guess that's my report. On to the treasurer now.
Accepted.
All right.
Thank you. Is it stuffed? Does it show up my pie? It doesn't show my pie graph.
Doesn't it?
It doesn't show anything that I do. Whoa. I'll get my... Is this because of the software?
Possibly.
Draw on the board. I know most of it from memory. We can download it from Dropbox. I'll put it up on Dropbox as well. A moment for your patience, please. Anyway, well, I'll tell you the gist of it. Very successful year for us. Not only we had a higher interest rate than last year, earned more in interest. We got $2,000 this year because we thrashed everyone at trivia.
Why did I forget that?
I don't know. When you said platinum year, I was like, you're right, it wasn't platinum.
Leave it to the treasurer.
Yeah. We practically won platinum, you know.
Precisely.
Which trivia led each
one? The big one. There are trivia weeks.
Several.
There's a weekly trivia, but...
there's one for all the clumps. All the clumps come together. And the top prize is $1,000, and we won it twice this year, last year.
And that's when we're not cheating, right?
We're not cheating.
Yes, yes. What is this?
Cancel it. I'll be late for that now.
Alrighty, never mind. Okay, so, never mind, my pretty pie chart, it's all over.
You don't have
I'll go to the last slide because it has a variety on it.
Is it on your laptop? Because we can just plug that into the screen.
Yeah.
Try your, you've got legitimate.
Open office is legitimate. I protest.
I'm not going on record answering that question.
Is it the same format?
The
yeah.
cable.
Oh, you
need the cable. Unless the cable can stretch it, but it
I'm sure it can.
Not that cable.
Oh, okay.
Stretch it.
Very
nice thing. Is there another bit of
Okay, so we're
For anybody listening to this recording in the future, we apologise for the delay and any inconvenience caused.
It's really
cool. City Rail appreciates your cooperation.
She's skipping through just like one frame of a stereo.
See, there it is. Very pretty.
Yeah.
Thank you.
No, it's fine. You don't need it. Just need the slide. How's it going?
Well, huzzah, shinies!
Alright.
Some colour.
Guys!
It's totally worth
it.
Mix these.
Yep.
So all as right. You can see, huge chunk. Oh my god.
Yes. We have a trivia based economy.
Here, here.
Next, membership fees. At present, we stand in excess of last count, and this was yesterday, of 110 members. That's both new and the ones who keep renewing, so alumni, etc. The one that can't really be seen, it belongs here, is the interest. That comes from our trivia winnings. So, yeah, we made 169% on our interest. Last year it was $1. This year it's $2.
Wow.
69, so very good figure.
The soft drink sales.
Yep. Can't forget the soft drink sales. Next, please. Expenses. Mostly laser tag.
Yeah.
So,
it's not a cheap hobby.
Paying for laser tag with trivia.
Yep. Next came the soft drink expenses for the room.
Are they more or less than the break?
Pay off?
The soft drink room?
Yeah, we more or less feeds itself. We sell the drinks and we buy them, and
it's an honest
cash
system.
So the drinks are in the room are like a good okay, it's a good thing.
Mm. And then we have the last year's AGM pizza and then $1. I think we're saving money this year. And then we had all the little expenses, like earn hire and the food for all our talks, which is an added expense from last year because we've just been doing more, being more active within the community.
Did the urn pay off as well?
No, we hired the urn, didn't we?
It's expensive.
Yeah, expensive.
So, but the urn was used for the IPv6, the ThoughtWorks, and for the security.
That was total. That was the...
They were hired for all
of them. Did you actually see people using them, or just like...
We didn't hire the urn for security.
Do you think we should?
Nah, no one drank coffee there.
Yeah, so...
So maybe
that's
we'll review that for next year. The necessity of the urn. So yeah, key points. Interest up, yes. Treasury is very healthy. Lesson learned, we just keep going in trivia.
What is what we currently have in the bank?
2,968. I can't remember the sense. The point is we're just about to tip to $3,000.
Okay.
So we're very healthy.
I thought we're over $3,000, but look at that.
Well, we are if you add all the petty cash, but that's what the bank statement says.
Okay.
So nothing really happened in terms of our capital goods this year. We didn't throw any machines out, nor did we buy anything.
Never really did.
That remains the same. No money spent on computers. So just everything functioned as it should. And just a note, so we have this great nest egg, and this is good because I think the new building's due to open in 2014. Yeah, and so then we'll be given a new room, and so we'll be able to decorate that to our heart's content with the money that we've accumulated.
So that's been confirmed, the new room?
The new room?
We'll get to that.
No, but
okay.
We've got lots of people on staff, so we're very confident.
Yeah.
All right, and thank you very much.
Okay. And next on the agenda is the report by our CSO, Chris Deigan.
Okay, hello, I'm Chris, I was the CSO. I haven't got a lot to say, just a few things.
Chart.
Pardon?
No
chart.
Sorry, no charts. I did charts last year. Can't have them 2 years in a row. Okay, now Tom already told you, through his tireless efforts, we have brought about account lockings so that people have a reason to keep paying us money even if they don't show up and want to still use their accounts. Probably the biggest change that's happened in terms of computers this year for the club is that we now sport a very tropical climate in the room, thanks to some double window glazing brought about due to the new building construction. Now, for anyone who did actually visit the room earlier, you probably would have noticed this. It's quite a bit warmer because we now don't have very good ventilation. The good thing is that our computers haven't exploded or fried or burnt or anything like that. And we have, due to the failing of one of our fans last year, we've commissioned a new fan in front of the servers to continue to provide that airflow. Other achievements of the year, the Cisco equipment that was missing for about a year or two has returned to the room, and through the efforts of, I believe, Thomas and Peter, has been labelled and inventorised. We also now enforce SSL logins for our webmail and wiki sites so that your passwords are not being transmitted in the clear. Besides that, I think, I mean, our network of computery things is pretty reliable. The main event of downtime this year was brought to you via a failed switch at ITD. And that was conveniently just before the before O-Day. Yes. The good thing is they, on both of those occasions, well, we actually had two occasions of downtime with that. On both occasions, they fixed it within a couple of hours of the beginning of the day after I reported it. And we also did some crazy things through UTS Wireless for one evening. But yes, apart from that, good year. We've had two more computers donated to us, one by John Elliott and another by, I believe, Thomas Given Wilson and Chris Laughton.
Yeah.
Yeah. And at this stage, in terms of computing inventory, we really have more computers than we have things to do with them.
Hmm.
So there's no real reason that we need to go expend any money on more computers. Are there any questions from the...
What's the state of backups? How's RAID?
Pardon? When is the second user machine going to be up? I think the real question is, with a second user machine, is there a requirement for one? Because, to be honest, my analysis of the use of the machine, the single user machine that we have, sorry, yeah, the first user machine that we have at the moment, it's not used an awful lot. There are regular logins from some people, but it's not exactly grinding under load or anything.
No.
Yeah. Yeah. I agree with you. At this point in time, we don't have a hot or warm standby user machine. That said, we do practically have identical hardware, so we are in a good position where we can literally swap the disks into an alternative machine should there be a hardware failure.
Sure, but redundancy
of the
file system slash
backup system. Yep, at the moment that is still a pending matter. Any other questions?
And now we move on to the key event of the evening, the elections of the 2012 executive. Calling the meeting to order, resuming the meeting. Turn to your seats, thank you. There we are. All right, now that we've all been suitably fed, it is now time for the elections of the 2012 executive. As it stands right now, there is just one candidate for each role of president, vice president, secretary, treasurer, CSO, first year representative, and alumni representative. Our main opponent, James Ducker, unfortunately pulled out this afternoon. And he states his reasons here. He just doesn't have the time to both serve as a program executive and serve on the ARC review, which he does as well. And here's his statement here. You know, that in electing the executive, more attention should be paid to the social aspect of the club. Find a president who is well-networked. Blah, blah, blah. Yeah. Which you can read in your own time. On the list, James Ducker. I don't know. So, president, just me. Are there any other nominations for president?
She nominated
somebody else.
Not seconded nor accepted.
Yeah,
and he's not
it wasn't
here tonight.
Seconded.
He's not everywhere.
Right.
Yeah, not losing here tonight.
Okay, so if there are no candidates, then Tom Bozic is duly elected as president of 2012.
You still have to give your speech.
Returning officer. Well, there's no need.
Who could be appointed returning officer?
Do you wish to...
I think we have an obvious candidate for returning officer.
Okay. So. Okay, returning officer. Do you approve?
We still have to vote on this, don't we? No. Count all zero votes and determine the top
Bozic people. Yay!
Now we move on to vice president. The only candidate is Kristina Coffey. Any other candidates? Any other nominations? Anyone? Bueller?
Can you be president and vice president?
No.
You're popular.
Yeah. Okay. No one? So, what say you, Rhys?
All 0 votes and determine the Constitution's effect on this.
And now, of course, now on to Secretary, Miss Kerry-Ann Chapman. Anyone wish to run for Secretary? Any nominations? Anyone else? Anyone? If you wish to give a speech, anyone, if you wish to give a speech, candidates, feel free.
I wanted to request a speech as well.
No, not that one.
Okay. What say you, Rhys? Your answer is duly appointed as Secretary of 2012.
There's like 7 different ways of saying this, and I really can't.
Yeah. Now we move on to Treasurer. Miss Livia Lamb. Any other candidates? Any other nominations?
Gavel.
The gavel.
Going once.
Yeah.
Sold.
Rhys?
We sold our treasure.
Sold the gavel.
100.
100
what?
Invisible dollars.
Okay, what say you, Rhys? What say you?
You just have a little election while I was chairman.
Sorry?
No.
Guilty.
I'm sorry.
Have you called
the
vote on CSI again?
No, I mean,
Treasurer.
We're still asking for Treasurer.
Yes.
Is it okay? Yes, it is.
Yes.
Okay, Livia Lamb is duly appointed as Treasurer for 2012. And now we move on to Computer System Officer. The only candidate so far is Mr. Peter Revelant. Any other nominations? Anyone else?
Anytime.
What say you?
Go!
Peter Revelant is duly appointed as CSO for 2012. And now we move on to first tier representative, Mr. Rhys Christian over there. Hi, Rhys.
Just a quick introduction, because this is your first time.
Yeah, okay, you probably should.
My name is Rhys. I am doing mind reader of business analytics. I'm doing first year, just after first year. And that is pretty much me in a nutshell, league-wise.
Okay.
Since you walked.
Right. Okay. No votes? Any other nominations?
No.
No? CK. Ooh. You second?
Really? I can represent the first years from up here.
Yeah.
For
you and
you
are hanging around the
descriptions,
what they do.
That's true.
Somehow
they end up in the Constitution
years later. No explanation. I'll just rule it out. Okay, you decline?
Okay.
Very well then, what say you, Rhys? Okay. Just backtracking a little, would Mr. Peter Revelant, the new CSO, like to make a statement?
An introduction, yeah.
Yeah.
My name's Peter Revelant. I am studying a master's in internet working, focusing on security. I've done sysadmin work before at Sydney Uni. Not a lot, nothing near as extensive as what Chris does in his job, but roughly about the same scale as what we've got here at the ProgSoc room. And I have a few things I want to do this year, which will be a lot easier now that I've been over to CSO. I want to test the CSO this, that, and the other. And I'll talk to you a little bit more about that later on.
Okay. Now we move on. Moving on now to the final role to be filled, the alumni representative. The only candidate is the 2011 incumbent, Mr. Daniel Comarmond. Are there any other nominations? Rav?
How red is your face right now? That's not going away in time, sir.
Is nobody going to nominate Rhys?
Anyone going to nominate Rhys?
You know, the whole plan thing proved to be totally simple.
Yeah, well, there's nothing in the Constitution. I'm sure there are other UTS alumni in Singapore who you can represent.
There are amazingly people. There are, and there are amazing people.
All right. So if there are no other nominations...
Does anyone want to abstain from the vote?
No, because they don't get voted for.
Yeah, very nice.
So I count all the votes. Okay.
Gives me great pleasure to reappoint Mr. Daniel Comarmond to the role of alumni representative. Yay. And yes, just a little historical note here. This is only the third time that this has happened. It's happened in 2000 and in 2001 that all the candidates have been elected unopposed.
Wow.
So cool. Add that to the annals of history.
One of the officeholders in each of those years was
it? Yeah.
Same.
Yeah. Okay, next thing. Constitution allows us to have up to 4 non-executive key holders, those people that have keys to the room. Any nominations for that? Yeah, I mean, okay, Jenny, if you would second me.
I second.
You second Jenny. Right. Okay, Jenny, what would you do?
Would you like a key?
Would you like a key to the room? You know, what would you be doing for us? Okay, I guess, would you like to maintain the cleanliness of our room, say? Be our room lady. Room cleaner.
No.
First act as president.
2012.
All on video, live on video. Yes.
That's going to be a golden news.
Do you want to have other key holders only at AGM, or can it be done at a later time?
It can be.
I was really appointed by one of you.
It's an exec function, so it doesn't have to be done.
Right.
Can you please cover off who are the default key holders?
Okay, the current key holders, the default key holders are obviously the people on the executive.
So all president, vice president, secretary.
Yes.
Is that first year as well?
First year, everyone on the executive.
Okay. Okay.
That's right, I did ask, but you...
Well, it's not everybody in the executive. You and I are the only incumbents. So.
Right.
But I'm not going to, the key's wasted.
Okay, so... And these are the current key holders at the moment, James Ducker, Livia, and Thomas. Oh, as many as they can cut, but normally we only allow up to 11, so... Sorry? Yeah. Sorry?
Yeah, where is Thomas?
Thomas had to leave.
No. But he has 4 votes.
How do you recover all keys?
How do you recover? I go pester people. I ask them. Yeah, I asked James Kersoff last year and he gave his back.
When I was secretary, I managed to ask it from John.
Sorry?
But I failed.
Who else would you like to nominate? Who? Chris Deigan? To keep his key? Yep. Okay.
I second.
Right. Okay, what about Tina and Priscilla, who are outgoing exec? Would you like to return your keys, or would you like to remain?
I don't know. Would you like to? It's required.
I don't want the key.
Okay, so...
It's not... You can use my hand.
Well,
yes.
I'd like to nominate Sean Williams for the key holder.
Right.
He's around and he can help out. I'm for Chris...
Okay, so he'll be a PFY or something?
Yeah.
Right.
And I'll just be CSO and that will make you a bastard operator.
Bastard operator, yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Anyone want to catch?
I ask Keith.
I mean,
yeah,
yes. I know. I mean, turn him in here. I mean,
we can make it the new position.
Yeah, hold on to that. I mean, priority will obviously be the two new key holders on the executive. They will need to get keys first, and then if there are more to go around, we'll, you know, sort that out, and then obviously ask Dean's unit as well, who's whispering.
I presume that Thomas will be keeping his because
yes.
of his role as Shadow Dictator and Optimus.
Yes.
Yes.
Oh,
okay.
Sorry? Okay, so let's Rick.
Do you want a white cat to stroke while you...
Yeah. I have to move out a bit, yeah.
Shall we continue?
There we go.
Yeah.
Anyway.
That's disgusting.
Stroking
the
hammer.
Can we do bank count signatures afterwards?
Sorry?
Can we deal with bank count signatures afterwards?
Yes, yes, we'll definitely be doing that afterwards. We'll have to use them at the conclusion of the meeting for that.
We have plenty of time for general discussion now.
Yes.
Can we
right.
talk about stuff?
Now we can. Now we're into general business, and we have plenty of time to do it this year. Excellent.
Tom, were the other key holders decided, or?
Right. So let's recap.
The key
Jenny...
holders are Jenny, Chris, Sean Williams, and Thomas.
Right. Okay.
Voting system for the bank account stuff, is that intentional? I'm just wasn't sure if it's needs to be.
Sorry.
The bank account.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it has to be minuted that. All this stuff, you know, because the bank demands this of us.
Mm-hmm.
They demand a copy of the AGM minutes. So
we'll deal with the bank signatories afterwards.
Yeah.
Okay.
All good. Yeah, I'm just a little thing. Voting procedure. Little, Andrew Halliday brought up something on the list. He wasn't too happy. You read that?
No.
Yeah. Just nodding along.
Yeah.
Here's the thing. We accept nominations, as you know, at the AGM itself, but some people don't like that. They prefer... like, a close of nominations after a set number of days so that absentee voting would be allowed. I mean, I don't know.
What was the reason behind absentee voting not being allowed? How was... There was something funny about the explanation. Absentee voting would be unfair on people who were absent there from 4 hours. Like, wait a minute.
It's not fair.
Well, that's what it
said. It's not fair because...
Yeah.
Not fair, basically, because new candidates can be introduced and... If you're absent, how do you know?
Prove the fairness problem by denying you people didn't vote at all.
No, what it?
Well,
no, in turn.
You have chosen the greater of two evils.
No, postal vote.
Yeah, but that's the thing. You've got on one side
yeah.
introducing candidates who want to be of service versus somebody who wants to be of service by voting.
Sure.
So
you say because there's a possibility of additional candidates coming to the meeting, therefore you can't vote absentee.
Oh, this
well,
is right.
A choice for the voting member to make, not for the.
Well, we do give him a choice. We give him a choice to nominate a proxy.
But can you specify to the proxy how you would like to vote?
Just call the directed proxy.
Yeah. Just
call the directed proxy. And generally, the answer is yes.
Yeah.
But it's
up to the proxy as to how they actually vote.
Yeah.
Yeah, combined with the proxy. Well, this happened last year, didn't it?
What?
We had proxy voting, and they
yes.
It's like, oh, it's up to me. I carry three votes.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. So certainly, the proxy voting being just a multiplier for the proxy
yeah.
holder makes sense.
Yeah, so...
Well, proxy holder is voting in three different ways, isn't it?
So I don't know.
I think it's a bit unreasonable to say to people, because of the possibility that new candidates might be nominated during the meeting, therefore you aren't allowed to vote absentee.
Yeah.
That's dumb.
Mm.
Doesn't quite make sense.
I don't know, so what should we do? Continue the system more or less as it is? Allow nominations? This is the big sticking point. Do we allow nominations at the AGM or do we close off? I mean, what do you think collectively works better?
You can make them force them to watch the video and then make their vote.
No.
So then they can cut off a week before the AGM.
Or 3 days or whatever, or 2 days. So that absentees can cast their vote fairly, you know.
It might be, I'm sure there's a safety valve, to allow nominations to only for uncontested, or indeed unnominated. positions. If you walk into an AGM with no nominees or no nominee position, maybe you don't make sense.
Yeah.
But if there are multiples, then perhaps they can be closed to people up front.
Right.
I don't know. I mean, here's the thing. I got here by walking into an AGM
yep.
and then saying, I think I'll go for that position, and I'm still here.
And it works.
We're glad that it happened, right? So I'd like that opportunity to be open to other people who may not necessarily fully appreciate what the AGM entails, what the roles entail. So I found out the role description on the evening and said, I can do that. So I hope I'm not going to be the last person to do that, and I'd like that avenue to still be open.
Yeah, and also it makes it, you know, more fun and spontaneous as well. I mean, yeah. Under normal circumstances, not now. This is bloody boring, you know, but...
Okay, look, I've got Andrew's proxy, and I think it's done, so let's just stop it.
What?
It was his idea, so...
Andrew's proxy?
Yeah.
What have you done?
I'm just rejecting it.
I'll message him now.
What?
You got
I don't think it was directed, did it?
Yeah. So...
I'm saying, on his behalf, I'm withdrawing the proposal.
So what?
His objection is...
I don't think...
Oh.
You can't do that.
No.
Right, so... What then is the general consensus? Continue as usual, or...? Yeah, so general consensus continue as normal, or...?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Right,
yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yes, Livia?
Yes.
Yes.
Right.
Does anyone feel that either proxies shouldn't be possible, or that nominations during the meeting shouldn't be possible?
Sorry, absentees or proxies, what you said?
Well, I guess anyone free. Does anyone object to there being absentees, there being proxies, or there being...
Yes, Peter.
Question. What if a nominee has proxy votes? If they leave the room, like has been done in the past, how can they then?
They obviously don't count, do they?
No, they should be able to lodge the vote of their proxies before they leave the room.
Would it be fair? That's the principal difference between having UA proxy. Would it be fair though if those proxies, well, it's not entirely fair, but if
that's the risk of the person choosing the proxy, don't you?
Yeah, that's the thing. And then the proxy then says, oh, I'm going to be part of this. Then the other two, the proxy votes, then disappear into thin air.
Yeah.
You can't use them. Well, you can't exercise proxy votes if the proxy then decide, I'd like to, you know, be up for nomination.
There's
a conflict of interest.
Yes.
Candidates, even though a candidate could be running for a position, that candidate still gets a vote.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There's no conflict.
Yeah.
That's just to be clarified,
yeah.
So I mean if you walk out of the room, I mean the vote walking out of the room thing's just amazing.
All right. So you vote before you walk out of the room and you can vote the proxies before you walk out of the room.
Yeah, I mean
yeah.
The fact
that
we say just walk out of the room.
That's all I wanted to know if they count or not.
You can't the deal with proxies that was described in the proceeding was that if you're holding boxes, they simply count them onto your standard vote. That makes more sense. So when you're voting for a contested role, of course, you take the standard vote who's voting themselves. Yes, they do. Yes, they want to be counted.
So are you saying that the only proxies we have are not directed proxies? They're solely at the discretion of the proxy holder?
I would suggest that the meeting should recognize the directed proxy at one thing. But what happens if the proxy decides to ignore direction? It's a
really
local area.
Break out the dance floor by right.
Well, yeah, it's sort of make that's the principle to separate proxy government from national voting. That's the principle.
Yeah.
In some structures, absentee voters, direct proxies have more or less the same status as absentee voters.
Okay. Are there rules about the proxy has to be lodged in the room of the or something. And actually, it would be lodged with the secretary.
We would
need to notify the secretary that this person has to be.
Historically, the entire exec has been notified. Historically, the entire exec has been notified. And that provides at least some degree of.
Yeah, okay, that's a mailing list. But you can't just turn up with something.
Yes. Yep.
But I'm trying to work out if that's written or that's just an assumed rule.
It's a convention, and you.
Yeah.
This was not something that was ever seen as reasonable to try and pin down the constitution. So it's a
thing is what we would like to do it. One that I might have planned to put in place was that we can't put on board in the leadership during the week.
Are you at Elden?
Yeah. After that fiasco. For those who don't know, talk about there was a hostile takeover attempt.
In 1997?
Yeah, about 97. During an AGM. Because we were accepting memberships and all the things.
It's definitely worth a read. Read through the mailing archives.
Was it the stalling attempt was to process the membership so slowly that
that was our English representative. But I worked out pretty quickly we're not going to be able to process. We would have thought maybe it would be requirement two. Not the first 20, we didn't answer that before. But that kind of surprises something.
Yeah. Yes, that's it. The only motion that could be carried. And then, yes, reason for brief AGM, that's what you originally wrote at the time.
Yeah, and then it got worse.
Yeah.
And the entire thing is that
so then you had to stack it the other way, did you?
I didn't stack it. I proposed a rather dodgy implementation of 14, which the exec went with initially, and then all of the
fascinating history.
Going to look for real, and fortunately, only two of the three people who were going to take it turned up. So, we didn't therefore see the agent.
You mean the people trying to take it
didn't turn up? So, they didn't turn up the same. three of the 20 did, but the rest did not.
Strange.
But it was the best attempted meeting we've ever had. Do we have numbers?
Sorry?
In the minutes for that year?
For 2097.
Yeah, there were upwards of 100 people, I think.
Upwards of 100?
Yeah.
No, unfortunately, no.
the adjourned meeting, we don't have any information about attendance.
How many people? No.
It was 7,000.
It was big. We took what was the largest lecture theatre in the pool.
Wow.
I mean, those were the days.
So back to the matter at hand. Shall we vote on something?
Vote on the voting procedure. Yeah.
I don't think anything's changed.
Okay, continue the status quo.
Yes.
Right.
Anyone again?
Sorry?
The only
we've defined it.
Allowing absentees.
Sorry?
The other change I might propose would be allowing absentees.
Okay. Fair enough.
I think if someone chooses to put a committal vote down rather than point a proxy, it is reasonable for society to recognise that.
Okay, fair enough.
Even if additional candidates for the same position become available, or that person might have to be voted for, that's the choice making when voting absentee rather than point a proxy.
Okay, fair enough. We shall allow them next year.
Show hands.
Okay.
All right.
Yes.
Hands up high so I can actually count you.
Yay.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. Okay.
Yep.
All against?
Nay.
We were not happy with absentees being able to...
Hey, what did we just vote for?
Absentees. We're meeting absentees. Okay.
To allow absentees.
Were you not paying attention during the non-voting?
Anyone abstaining?
You are the minute saving.
No one abstaining.
Were there abstentions?
No abstentions.
Okay, no abstentions. Good.
Excellent.
But that can't be right, it's alright.
Okay, fair enough. Next, TFM. You'll note my little note here. It's become an annual tradition. And I make that note because, let's face it, I mean, TFM is, shall we say, in development hell. We actually started in earnest after like some 6 years of there not being addition. We started, yes, we're going to do a new TFM and we're going to publish it. In 2010, yes. That then became, if we just go here, a TFM by 2011. And then that became a new TFM by 2012. So, yes, three years it's taken. And, yeah, in terms of how much has changed, not too much. We're still waiting on the two people to finish their chapters. James Ducker, who is not here tonight, he's doing a chapter on HTML and web development. And Thomas, who left not long ago, is doing a chapter on computer science. Yes?
If we give a arbitrary date, if we choose a particular date and it's not ready by then we just promote a freaking thing. Is there enough guy or content in there to actually get out the door, or is it still terribly insufficient?
I mean, you'd have to make a tough choice. I mean, you wouldn't want to print a half finished chapter. It's still drop the chapter. That's what I mean. That is one possible solution. Yes.
The first line of that says a definitive guide to all things computer ETS. So
well, that might have been the case 10 years.
So hang on. So the thing is with faculties.
With
faculties merging and then demerging and systems moving around, how up to date really are the chapters, or are they getting out of date by the time they're written?
Well, let's just say there's a lot of old content that has not really been refreshed too much. Yes, Peter?
Can't you just put it on the wiki and then the printed one can come out whenever it wants to come out, but at least in the meantime we'll have something we can look at?
I believe that was once proposed by you, Raz.
Yes, it is. We actually talk about that every year, proposing to put the TFM on wiki.
I'd like to talk against that. The executive 10 years ago was fairly much against giving out the content. Based on the history of the society almost being built around it and the money from it. So we wanted to keep a price on it, not only just to give it a symbolic value, but also
I'd like to make a proposal that the same idea of putting it on a wiki, but making that wiki only available to people who have a
membership.
Current
account. So that does work around the issue. That does pretty good, actually.
Floor recognizes Tina.
Sorry? I actually agree with what Chris said.
Okay, fair enough.
I was going to basically say that we've been surviving without selling the actual copies of TFM, but to using TFM as a way to attract membership, I agree with that.
Because I just want to add at the same time, although it's great to print it, as said before, things are really in a state of flux at the moment, and I think even after you've printed it, some of the information is only going to be valid for maybe a semester.
We should never
be honest. This day,
to put it off there because
fair enough.
I don't think we should put it off. I just think we should be more able to just keep content updated on some online form, even if we have a printed copy, which is a snapshot at some point in time.
Rob.
Either an online or a paywall, or just put it online at all. We have a society that pretty much runs entirely on stuff that people just said, I'm going to put fuckloads of effort into this and make it available for everyone. Everyone's been learning off reference material that people put fuckload of effort into and said, alright, I'm going to release it for everyone. Previously people would put a bunch of effort into the TFM and people writing chapters putting effort in as well, and you yourself would put a lot of effort in.
Yes.
Part of this open sharing hippie thing, man. Information wants to be
free.
Well, seriously, as in things that seem to be getting sort of more open with this sort of this sort of material, and let's just put it up. I just wanted to basically make a copy of it. Back when I was starting, I wanted a copy of the TPM, so I can learn how the LaTeX side was put together, the text, how it was actually being formatted. I couldn't get a freaking copy. It took me 4 years until I could actually get a copy secretly through a back door to David Andy get it. It was ridiculous to get a copy of this thing. I mean, people putting effort into it, but my god, this is just don't think it's worth putting behind a paywall or just stashing away. I think that it's become... It's only been relevant for a certain slice of time. Let's just get it out as much as possible before it becomes relevant.
Relevant is a good word because it's... We have not been making ourselves relevant to first years and actually doing that first line the last few years. The content has been held back. We've not shown ourselves to promise what we actually said we're going to do for new students.
Yeah.
We've got to make that available. So I don't agree with charging for the content. I think that especially having worked for technology companies where they used to charge for stuff, like Sun with Solaris, and they made it free, and Cisco with whatever, it's just the way it's going to have to go. You know, as Tina said, we have done without the revenue stream from TFM, but we in turn have lost our relevance.
Yep.
Yeah, I also want to add that if we make the content of TFM open, I'm very confident that we can still be recognized as the authors of TFM, even if it's openly available.
Right.
And I believe we can still attract new group members by being the fact that we are the author of those documents.
Mm.
And if they can access it freely and openly, they will even more easily recognize the value of TFM and then in turn recognize the value of ProgSoc. And that has more possibility of attracting a new job.
Okay, if we were to...
it's getting people's mind shifting.
Yeah.
Yes. It's about you put your idea and you grow a group of people around your idea by sharing.
It's generally that can be done openly or not, but doing it openly usually gives you access to a much better pool before they try or put out groups. The other is that the majority of stuff that advice is only going to be first, and then eventually gradually it will form upwards, and massively doing that.
That's another point as well. People who will still pay money for a book even with the same information is online available.
Right.
So the telephone book can be like the best of.
Yeah.
And if we have a wiki, then we don't need to depend on one or two people who are delayed in producing their content.
Yes.
Others will step in naturally and
Well, this is how we did it, but the video was not actually going to be finished product. It was a worksheet for you to get. And then pretty sure all this is what you thought.
Remember, all the writing effort we've had is going to be wasted.
So then, should the motion then be
to
make it online paid or online free?
I support online free. But if that's rejected, I'd like to see online paid if it's rejected.
If it's a wiki style modifiable, definitely
online
followable
members.
Yeah.
Or even
a subset. I don't know.
Online free, I'd say.
Yeah, definitely members online.
Editable by members as per
and
wiki at the moment, anyway.
Monitor by exec.
Yeah. I actually personally been thinking about that a long time anyway. So.
Finally.
it
was mentioned in previous AGMs.
What?
Putting the PFM on wiki.
Yeah. So we should do that then?
Does anyone oppose either of the.
You should stay with the last first.
Sorry.
You should say what they are first. For the notes, please.
Those being making it content free level or it's content available to members. So this is a straw poll, not called the vote.
The only question I have is, does that content belong to ProgSoc or does the content belong to people who work in the chapter?
Will property belong to ProgSoc?
Well, there's a statement at the beginning of the TFM that says, you know, the individual authors affirm the right to be identified as such.
The moral rights.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's
Dennis
rights.
Cook, Chris Fraser, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera.
But they're asserting the moral rights. Are they asserting copyright also or not?
No copyright per se, but they affirm the right to be identified, so
that's moral
rights.
That's
yeah. the copyright would therefore be... Yeah.
Is there a copyright notice identifying of ProgSoc cards?
Yes.
We could ask each individual contributor if they were willing to have their stuff put on the wiki. If they do, we put it up. If they don't, we don't. And some of us write it and they become irrelevant forever.
Yes.
Yeah.
Contributors.
Dennis Cook, Chris Fraser, Stephen Boyd, Gowing, Colin Panisette, Grant Heinrich, Chris Keane, Ian Sinclair, Ryle Shazwell, James Wondrashek, Anand Kumria, Chris Wood, Jason Crane, Naomi Hatchman, Paul McLaughlin, Matt Steeler, Dennis Clark, Olivia D'Annunzio, Peter Merrick, Andrew Wilson, Carolyn Choi, Piers Joyson, Christian Kent, Matthew Berrigod, Nicholas Fitzroy, Gary Marcinetti, Katie Flick, Thomas Gibbon Wilson, James Ducker, Chris Deigan, and me. A third on the right.
We'll put a motion that we put DTFM online in a format to be determined by the executive at some point soon to make it freely available and let's move on from that point.
Second.
Alright, yep. All in favour of making it freely available in one of the form online.
Yay!
Yay!
We can debate about what sort of wiki formats and stuff like that's going to take a type a lot of time.
But I'd like to raise another motion to have something published this semester regardless of its.
In print form.
This semester or this year?
Well,
I thought one for the semester.
Okay, let's call semester.
Okay.
So, did you imagine then that?
It'd be locked off for publishing.
Before the next update, for sure.
What it looks like. All
right, July 9th.
July 9th. The relevant chapters are
not done.
Still pending, it's going to be dropped.
Yep.
Okay.
Motion?
What do you want to do
there?
I'll move it.
All in favour.
Get the thing
we don't have a vote, no. Okay.
Right. Okay, so.
Yes.
Just my opposition. My opposition to printing it.
Yeah.
It's not a personal thing. I look at my own sheer bookcase worth of stuff out there, like Cisco certification books version 1, 2, 3 Academy books, and so on and so forth.
Yeah.
As much as there's going to be, you know, the updated wiki, at least it's the master copy.
One thing I haven't discussed yet is I would like to personally take on a project to make this into a big part of the model. One of the things I can do with that is to actually put a slider on the interface somewhere to let you go back into any previous issue, because there's some lovely, interesting stuff that goes on back to the bottom of the line, including the Facebook center. whatever you like. Equally, an iBook has this lovely thing that lets you republish any time for free to the current owners. So it will always update as well. And so we can always push new editions out for the token price or whatever. It would be cool if it was a token price that it might be found publicly via iBook. And if random people anywhere in the world like it, ProgSoc gets the profit. This is something I'd just like to hang a hook on to see if it works.
Yeah.
And there's a few other interesting things that you need to do before you get an iBook done, which is to go to the United States Internal Revenue Service and get the equivalent of the tax file number. So these are interesting things that I wish to enjoy.
Yeah. Okay.
That we can all learn from.
Yeah. I mean, I was going to, just before we continue, I actually did go to printing services last week, thereabouts, and I mean, the quoted price for 220 pages is $8.65 per copy. So how's that?
That's fine.
Yep.
Sure, that's
very right, so charge $10, I guess. $10. Yeah.
How many?
I asked for 50, so... So it's 432.50 XJST, right. And turn around for printing 3 days. So that's quite reasonable. All right, moving on then, I guess. The mug. Yeah, basically, we only have two left in the room. Just two.
And how many acclaims?
Is this Devbug or is this the...
What's that one? The help guide, how to make coffee. That one. That's the most recent one. And I've personally been drinking out of it every day for 3 years, so... I wash it.
Thank you for sharing.
It's okay, I've been using it for a year.
Yeah.
Are we going to run a little informal competition to design new design?
Yeah, that's probably what we should do. Shall we have a competition?
Do you have a date in mind to choose the design? I like May 1. How's that sound?
Okay.
May 1st.
Very agreeable. Isn't that rather close to... How close is that to exam? How close is that to the exam period?
Exams are in July.
Exam is June.
June.
The entire June. So.
Yeah, midterms
are... I'm looking at my first year rep for finance in this section.
Yeah, it should be around that. Well, the mid semester is around the end of April.
So that's my first then.
Yeah, so...
So we're like creative energy. It's
like April 16th
to 23rd. Yeah. And naturally, we'll have to consult, with a company as well, and get a quote for price as well.
Do we need that soon?
Sorry?
Do we need that soon?
Not really. No, it's not of urgency.
I just like setting early dates because things get
done. It is a thing. I mean, the next sale opportunity would be the next O-Day in mid-year. That doesn't take place until August,
I like to think that every time the door is open, it's a sale opportunity, right? It should be a sign,
$5,
whatever.
Okay, fair enough.
Yeah, but people still need time to know that there's going to be this going on. They would even prepare. I'm just thinking from the point of a competitor.
The executive can choose a date.
All right.
I'll put my entry in.
Okay.
Right?
Black and white, of course, in keeping with the tradition.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Closing the entry details.
Yeah, something.
Yeah. Okay. Now on to more, I guess, important issues. Whatever. Get a room. That refers to our new headquarters in the new Broadway building, which is currently a hole, a deep cesspit in the ground.
And that's now recorded in
HD. So we're buying up the plan.
Yeah. Here we are.
Well, it was, but now it's not. Sorry?
What's the status of negotiations?
Right. Getting into that. Last year. Okay, where are we? First thing, about July, the first thing I did was do a bit of research. I actually measured measured the dimensions of the room. It's about 18 square metres and 48 cubics. To give the people some idea of how much space we take up, and I measured the benches as well, and the shelves, and the server enclosure, and the fridge, and the whiteboard, and the window, that sort of thing.
That's already allocated, that's decided now?
No, that's what we've got. Existing room.
This is what we stand to lose.
How likely are we getting?
Okay, no, we'll get to that now. I mean, this was all part of research for July, DECOM, wasn't it? Lothar Weber, yes.
Wow.
So yeah.
So you've met with this person.
We have met with him.
Yeah.
Presented the measurements.
I'll shut up now. Continue.
Right. So yes, we had that meeting, and then we pretty much suggested, and I got the floor plans for the cesspit.
Oh, yeah. What floor was that?
Okay, this is the basement, right? Wait. No. See, here, you have the server enclosure, right?
Oh, aerodynamics.
We could have an underground lair. That's one possible.
You want that white cat again, don't you?
Next year. Next year, aerodynamics.
My cat's black.
It's going to be really loud.
With this suggestion, he's not suggesting we just get some space in the server room for servers.
Morally.
Actually,
but what about
the functions that we have now? Users can meet there and so on.
I mean, that's why it's less than ideal.
Yeah.
You're talking about
the
rack space,
and
I'm talking about the club room.
Yeah.
So,
thoughts of club room?
Is there a problem with that approach?
Yeah, I mean, that's the thing. I mean, here we have here, level 5.
Yeah.
This is sort of like the student society's kind of level.
Yeah.
And we even asked, you know, if we could occupy one of these rooms, but as we later found out, they were more or less inadequate for our needs.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, because they just don't, there's just not enough room. They weren't really designed for...
Too small?
Or
yeah, a bit too small.
Draw a square where ours would be.
Ours
is now. How big is our one now?
Our one is level 3. Let's go back to level 3. Where are we at the moment?
Level 4.
Okay. Level 3. That, I reckon that's us there. About there. I would say we're about there.
Two adjacent rooms.
Two adjacent rooms. That will be us there.
No, I think we're...
No, you go to the big room.
This, yes, there we are.
Yes.
That's us.
Right. So that's all we need.
Yeah.
Okay. And what are they offering us?
Oh, that, the base. Okay, offered us like space in the basement, and they also offered us.
That means the request.
Yeah.
So that means your request is understood. You're being offered rack space. You're being offered.
No,
space
no, no,
service,
wait.
So that's not covered.
What have they offered us?
I'm getting to it, please. Bear with me. Level 9. Level 8. Level 7, a room basically, you know, in the school of software, right?
One of those?
Yeah, one of these little things, or one or two of them, you know.
Cool.
Yeah. Which probably would be more ideal because it's, you know, closer to level 5, a social thing, and you know, we're co-sided with the school of software, a strategic sort of alliance.
Does it contain any of those?
Yes, Livia.
What date is that plan?
This would be from last year. Has it? I'm sure it's been revised since.
2011,
yeah.
What happened to that little area that was allocated next to the Comarmond Society?
That little area.
I had a look at the plans too, and I saw a room up
there. You know, on level 5, which ones?
I don't know which version of.
But anyway,
there
are like three society rooms, though. On level 5, you have 3 society rooms. Women and IT, student societies,
and
basically, Lothar told me.
Student societies.
Yeah, no. Lothar told me it's like basically it's a pamphlet room. It's a room where you pick up pamphlets and sign up for clubs.
Oh.
That's what it's designed for.
So
it'd be totally inadequate for our needs, which is why he suggested either the basement for our servers or level 7, you know, to be co-sided with the school of software.
Stuffing into rooms. If we've got a machine room with rack space, then
yeah.
Yeah.
I must say, it is still a tentative suggestion.
So, yeah, so level 7 is basically offices for academics.
Yeah.
So, what's the projected foot traffic for that room? When you consider that the room we had over here was next to the tech support desk initially, there was lots of foot traffic.
Yes.
And then tech support moved.
Yeah.
And we stayed.
Yeah.
Less people went past the door and said, what the heck is that? So what do you project? What's near us over there that you think would actually make good, you know, good visibility?
I mean, are you suggesting we should try to be as co-sided to tech support as possible?
That would not be
not necessarily tech support, but anywhere with high traffic.
Yeah.
I mean, yes, we definitely... These are all tentative suggestions, by the way. Nothing's set in stone. There will be further negotiations, obviously, this year.
Do we know where that's for tech support?
And that's and this is a map from 2011. I mean, I'd like to get a floor plan for 2012. Yes, yes.
On this map, we know the whereabouts of the.
It would probably be close to ground level, possibly level 3, but there would. I mean, tech support is ITD. I mean, but there'd be one on every level, you know.
Is there a deadline for when we need to have our submission in or approved? And we don't want to see too late.
Do we understand the decision-making process?
Chris has Johnson. Well, yeah. I mean, Chris has Johnson's leaving.
Is he?
Yeah. So, and he was off the cuff, very pessimistic about us getting a room. So I'm just want to insist. I want to impress upon everybody that it's very important that we get this done. And make sure we keep asking the heads from them. Is it going to happen?
Have we discovered what the decision-making process is?
Can we get the one person to find this out and be the liaison?
Right.
Perhaps somebody who's staff here and knows people?
I volunteered for this role, so I'm making the research and development
office. Excellent.
Well,
so you'll be our chief negotiator.
See if I can figure out first.
Yeah.
You're interested at the meeting so far.
Sorry?
So, you know how you said the message low
far? Yeah, yeah.
It was you and...
DCOM.
DCOM, yeah. I'll talk with you guys.
Yeah, obviously.
We'll give you a cat to stroke later.
Yes.
Thank you.
I just mean that. Everyone gets a cat.
You get a cat.
Yeah.
That's a group photo.
So is this going to be cat five?
Yes.
So, okay, the reason the initial room you were talking about was inadequate was because it was a room with a door that had, what, a power point or something?
Yeah, like just...
Why was it inadequate? If something came up as a potential... thing, why was it rejected out of hand?
Yeah, because it was not really intended for that purpose. And it was too small for our needs. And I told him it's like 18 square meters. I think it's significantly smaller than that. You know, and...
Well, I'm probably looking at the shapes of the map that looked roughly equivalent.
Yeah.
I'm a little confused as to why it was rejected.
Was it a power and ventilation thing?
Yeah, I would say so. If you can recall from, not really.
No. It rejected.
It was more or less rejected out of hand. I mean, we suggested by Lothar. We suggested to Lothar, like in our request in the email that I wrote. You know, we'd like perhaps these rooms. You know, and then they said, well, no, I got a better suggestion. You know, the server room, or skill software.
How did the tech services and asset manager get involved? There's no way he has authority for allocating rooms in the entire development.
No, I wouldn't say he has the authority, but he was probably the best person that we could find at the time. I mean,
he was actually the person suggested to speak to by the dean's unit.
Yeah.
Did
the
dean
understand
we were looking for a club room or did we look for a server room? The tech services says to me that this is going to turn into a... We're just going down a ramp hole, which has... have any possibility of getting the room yet?
Yeah, I understand. I spoke to the dean's unit saying for a club room. I didn't mention service at all. I didn't request it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
If you're going to take this on, I would suggest that a very high priority is to discover what the decision making procedure is.
Yeah.
Who decides, how they decide, when they decide.
Right.
But who and how as well as when.
Hmm.
If we don't know those things, then what's likely to happen is we'll be talking to people who have no ability to change the decision long after the decision has been made.
Peter.
How often does the exec meet? The reason being is I want to know how frequently I'll touch with people like this.
We don't meet per se. We have a mailing list.
Email.
Yes.
Okay.
We have an executive mailing list. Most of our correspondence is done through there. I mean, unless you wish to have, you know, minuted regular meetings, if that's...
Shall we leave that up to the exec?
Yes.
Yeah. No, I was just wondering about the frequency.
Yeah.
But we can do that very
much.
Should I send you a wiki page for it?
If you like.
Yeah.
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 Including all the top
guests.
Yeah. Another petition.
Yeah.
Links to the
diagram. Yeah.
Mm.
All right. Okay, so, a review of ProgSoc objects as suggested by DCOM.
Should we look at the objects?
Okay.
Filthy
objects.
So why this came about was when I was arranging some of the talks last year.
Yes.
And we were looking at advertising for the IPv6 for the security for the ThoughtWorks one as well.
Mm-hmm.
So I personally was hoping to reach out to other faculties, especially for the security one, given that it was designed to be a talk on security to, you know, anybody without a technical background, not in the IT faculty.
But given that where the current mission statements and basically, you know, what does the ProgSoc stand for, doesn't necessarily point to outside the faculty. I was looking to see some sort of modernisation to broaden where ProgSoc could, you know, have some sort of relevance to the rest of the university. Mm.
Cool. Question. But what about, say, within the university restricted to the IT background? So, what are those objects restricted in any fashion?
Our expertise has gone beyond computer programming.
Okay.
And you know, yeah, even the subjects have changed from when you and I were undergraduates here to what they're
doing. The point is that the expertise in computer programming was largely non-IT, as I understand it. This was engineering more than the science. When ProgSoc started, there is a basis on which we got to be affiliated.
Mm-hmm.
We're not academic specific. And in fact, we're already demanded in the majority of the time. I don't know what the current situation is, but the idea that only IT people are capable programmers is historically not correct.
Yep.
Fair enough. It doesn't seem to be reflected much over here that we can have a wider, you know, be better relevance to others. You know, we should. I'm personally putting it out there that we shouldn't just be about programmers. This is the first one up there, and that somehow when we do seminars, talks, events, that we consider how could this be useful for journalism students, how could this be useful for business students, so on and so forth. Because when current students in the faculty do move on, they have to consider who their customers are going to be internally to an organisation, or if they work for a vendor, who their customers are going to be externally. So it's a kind of behaviour that I'd like to start encouraging a little bit right now. Does that make sense?
Hmm.
It makes sense. Do you have objects in mind?
Mm-hmm. No, because I didn't realise that was going to be on the agenda.
Ah, yes.
Okay.
No, is it aspirational?
Yeah.
Okay.
It is.
It's probably something that needs to happen over a period of time anyway.
Yeah,
sure. A new, if we're talking constitution type document, to have that first appear doing the same agent, it's better on the program. It's something that needs to happen at a period of time.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I don't see the policy particularly against original objectives. In fact, what the Constitution calls are not original objectives, which is in the first or second paragraph of this, that it was an even narrower focus when we started. It broadened by the time we created society.
So there's no reason not to adjust, certainly considering something years on. If
okay, it is kind of hard.
Another reason for this as well is to consider, like you've started attending networking events.
Yeah.
You know, there are more events being run by your Googles and Microsofts, your Telstra's the world now, graduates, and to actually hand to them, you know, like an executive summary, this is what ProgSoc stands for these days, this is what we do, this is why we encourage students from all faculties to join, is going to look better. Right now, those objects as they are would not stand up in front of, you know, at a graduate program even, information even for your PwC, for your Ernst & Young, for your Microsoft, your Google. So that's just something else to consider as well. Now, you're right in that I haven't brought objects of my own. Sorry, my pockets are empty.
That's fine.
It's a
discussion.
Any other thoughts on that?
I'm generally in favour, but I'm just wondering, because we don't have specific objects in mind, does that mean we're going to have to wait until the next AGM?
No.
I was going to say June
30th. Yeah. Call next year on June 30th.
Nothing like the taxis.
There's always an argument for removing the objective on learning to do further.
Then we would need a
very limited progress that Priscilla may have put into the fund. But it will take time for things to be discussed, for any steps to be attempted, for consensus to be built, so that you walk into an SGM immediately after AGM, so that will change. That shouldn't happen from a cold start.
So you need an SGM.
Is it here in the
Yeah.
Formally as an SGM, if you do
things out of the SGM.
But,
yep.
That shouldn't happen from cold start.
Mm-hmm.
I would suggest that it should be a case that it needs to be tried, historical or heritage, certainly with the catalogue of disciples from Solomon's open address, that might be a good basis for re-specifying the objectives. And yeah, no reason why that shouldn't be changed.
Yeah. A few years ago. Yes, Rob.
Grow it around the boundaries for a while and then do an SGM date and then get on with it.
Excellent.
In terms of data tape, I mean, hash out something, then read to an SGM vote and then carry on.
Yep. No.
SGM second week of second semester?
Yeah. Sounds like a plan.
Yeah. Kick around all this first, and you need to at some point.
Yes.
Before you do this. And if that happens, then you go straight. It happens. Thanks for the idea. That's fine. They've been in that form for 20 years, but it's
right.
This is something that, this in particular, is why it's Article 1 or 2 Constitution needs to be dealt with.
Yeah.
In a fairly measured way.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay. Agenda number 6, then, programming competitions.
Okay.
Peter.
Can you get my webpage on ProgSoc?
Yeah, ProgSoc.org, Revelant.
Yeah. The top one.
There we are.
There's been a lot of talk about how we should be expanding our role, and I agree with all of that. But at the same time, I don't want to lose focus on programming, since we're the programming society, and particularly picking out this object to encourage, foster, promote the expertise in computer programming within the university. There are a number of ways. Well, we are already doing that. In particular, when I joined ProgSoc, it was recommended to me that I look at the boiler problems, which are on the wiki, which are an appropriate start for people to develop their programming expertise. But generally, universities where there are programmers aspire to entering and winning the ACM, International Collegiate Programming Contest.
Mm-hmm.
I entered this when I was an undergrad at Sydney Uni, and it was quite interesting. And to give a brief explanation of what it is, in a period of, I think it was 5 hours, a team of three of us had to solve 8 problems, or as many as we could in a particular amount of time. It's programming language agnostic. What they're really looking for is your ability to apply algorithms to problems and implement them in your coding language of choice. So it's more computer science based, and I see at UTS in the undergrads there tends to be more of a focus on web programming where algorithms aren't dealt with so much, although I know there are courses that do deal with data structures and algorithms here. But regardless of that, I mean, some students will take those courses and some students who don't will have those skills, or who don't have exposure to these kinds of problems by trying to do these problems in a contest format might develop into better programmers. So point one here is that we should support people, encourage people to form a team to join the ACM contest, the first stage of which is the South Pacific contest, which is held in September. That might be difficult for people with no experience or who don't know anything about it. So as a lead-up or to prepare, there are a number of things we could do. Some of them are other competitions which are run online, which have very similar problem formats. For example, Google Code Jam, which is already open right now. You can enroll and join that. That's done online. The problem formats are very similar. You're given a problem such as something like a traveling salesman problem or a bin packing problem, for those of you who know what they are. Sometimes they're more straightforward. You're given a data set and asked to filter out certain records from the data. which is something which is probably more familiar to what a lot of students here will do in their everyday classes. People can join that on their own. As a society, we can also encourage people. But the main thing I wanted to address tonight is this point number two, that ProgSoc actually run a contest, not an online contest, one held on site here at the uni, which would be much closer in format to the ACM contest, because you need to go to a contest site. You go into a room. You're allowed reference materials, but you can't consult with people. There's a time limit. And to do that, the software used to run the ACM competition is actually freely available, so we can use that. So we could make a competition which is almost exactly like the ACM one, mm-hmm. though what I would propose would be that we have more easy questions so that people who won't be intimidated by the difficulty of ACM level questions, and everyone who participates, even people who are still beginners at coding, will be able to solve two or three problems to get a feeling of accomplishment, and they can work their way through. So these other things we can promote online, but the running our own competition requires more organisation. We'd advertise it. What I envision is that we'd advertise it through the university, so anyone could enter a team. We would need a location, somewhere to do it. The ProgSoc room is too small. I'm thinking what we could probably organise is to book one of the labs. Of course, we'd have to do it at a period when the labs are free for booking. We could probably fit 4, maybe 6 teams in each lab. And some of us could administer. It's a server client system. Teams have clients. Judges have clients. Everyone has clients, and there's an admin. We could run the admin from ProgSoc room or from one of the labs. I've already done some prototyping on that, and that's easy enough to do. But I can't run a whole competition on my own. What we would need, and this is what I'm going to ask you to do a quick straw poll as to who might be interested in, on the day, we would need admins, probably 2, just in case one keels over and dies, so that we have redundancy there. Judges. Judging is, it's mostly machine marked. It's automatically judged, but a human judge can check if something is not quite right or if a team queries it. An admin could do that too, but it's easier if there's at least one extra judge. Someone to act as the master of ceremonies, the main contact point to talk to teams, because the admin may be busy taking care of the back end and won't necessarily be available to talk to teams directly. And then other support staff, depending on how many teams we get, if we have a lot, we'd need more people to take queries from staff, relay them to the admins, make sure the food was there and so on. Not on the day, but for preparation, we need people to write the problems, and I would like some people to test them, just to write the code and make sure that the given inputs, the test inputs and outputs, are actually correct, which would, I'd probably ask the more experienced coders among us. So, can you just raise your hands now? Assuming that you were available on the day, would you be interested in being an admin? Yeah, okay, good. So we could cover that. Would you be interested in being a judge? Okay, we could cover that anyway. More importantly, would you be interested in being an MC or other contact support staff? We would need a few of these.
Okay.
This would not require any particular technical ability. You don't have to be a coder to do this.
Okay.
The people who write the problems, need to be good coders. And but the general support staff don't have to know anything about coding. So we can probably do that. Who would like to be a contestant?
I'll
On the prices, right?
Depending on the contest. Depending on the contest, but we try and make lots of easy questions so that.
I just got a point. It's not just about easy. If possible, make it fun as well. Because at the present, since I joined the UTS at 2007, some of the technical subjects, programming subjects, the labs are already designed in a way like a competition. We have lab exercise that we have to complete within that hour of the tutorial, and the reward is the marks, the lab marks, which contribute to the final marks, and those problems are generally technical, I would say, and if there's something with a bit more of an entertaining contest and entertainment value, that
there is
would
scope,
be really worth it.
There is scope to do that. Currently, there's a balloon system already built into the software where you get a balloon every time you solve a problem. But we could do something else. There's no reason we can't do something else on top of that. Virtual or physical. Another thing is, though the competition is, the ACM competition is team-based, there's no reason, with the software, we can have individual entrants as well, but I thought that's something we could decide later. There could be individual or group entries. Then, last two, who would be willing to write problems for this? You would be able to see example problems from these other ones before you wrote it to give you an idea. Anyone who's done an undergraduate degree in computer science, there's no time frame on this, so you should be able to do it.
I love tradition.
Yeah? Yep. I think we could probably scare up. And then testers. Testers would need some coding ability. Okay, so I think we've got enough numbers, even with just people here, that it's feasible. Tom, what would be, should I make a motion that we I'd like to make a motion that we hold it and set a date, and then we let the executive take care of the details.
Right.
Regarding a date, I have two in mind. My favourite was the last week in April, which is Vice Chancellor's Week. It's after the midterms, so there's a gap. Students are free. They're not going to lectures. They have a few assignments, but generally they could turn up. It's not a high-stress period.
But we'd have to get very busy, though.
The problem is, yes, it's only 1 month away, and we still, if we book a room through the faculty, we'd need to organise that within a month, and I don't know if that's possible.
Yeah.
It's possible.
It is possible?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. The alternative, the only real alternative that I can think of is the end of July, the week before the spring semester, when people come back. Now, students are more likely to still be on holidays then. But if we wait until Vice Chancellor's Week in spring semester, that is at the end of September, which is after the ACM competition. So really, we'd want to hold this before the ACM competition so that teams who did well could experience it and then be encouraged to enter the ACM competition.
Great.
What's on with the first weeks of August?
Just the lecturers are on.
Yeah, but in the first 4 weeks, everyone's a bit relaxed and it's sort of their time.
Maybe
yeah.
in the first week.
Oh, yeah.
Well, first two or three, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, well, then ideally the first week of August, because they'd be, maybe because they'd be most relaxed and that would still give them enough time to...
We still have potential class clashes, though, if it's during the teaching.
You think so?
I think so. People are already having clashes with ProgSoc Thursday meetings, so... Dial-based programming, for example, that's always on.
There you go.
I was going to say, because we're doing the second week, then everyone would have the first week to kind of, would it be like a group? Would you have to have a group for you?
If you were going to enter as a team, it would, yeah, otherwise you'd probably be better off. One thing I was thinking was, by allowing individual entry, people who don't know two other people to form a team would be able to meet other individuals there and then maybe form a team for the main one. Another question I should put is a weekend viable? Mm-hmm. I don't mind coming in to run it on a weekend. In fact, I think for ProgSoc members, it's easier because a lot of us work.
Does this worry students with
depends on how they live on campus, I suppose. You don't need to have on campus.
I can't really say. I mean,
is that undergrad or postgrad?
It can be either. We're mainly aiming for undergrads, though.
It lasts for one day, right?
One day, probably half a day. The ACM contest is, I think, about 5 hours.
Yeah.
But our contest could be shorter. I'm thinking 3 hours.
Could we just do it on an afternoon on Thursday? Have a look at the timetables first, and then we'll see if there's not many
lectures
on for software
stream
or something on Tuesday.
Yep. Is there a complete reference somewhere that you can find to like see what day has met how many class, etc.?
There are timetables online.
Yeah.
Like a console, like a really console.
There is a timetable thing you can look up for memory. You have to pick all the subjects out.
Yeah.
Right.
On the other side, there's the staff aspect, which I can ask you now, for all the people who put their hands up a minute ago. Would you be more willing to come in on a weekend or a weekday? This is only for the people who have to be available on the day. Problem writers are free to do it whenever they like. So for people who might be staffing on the day, would you prefer a weekday? Yes?
Are weekdays out of the question?
Not out of the question, no.
Yeah.
All right, well, we'll split that up. Weekday in the day before 5 o'clock.
There you
go. Yeah, you can put your hand up more than once. Weekday evenings.
Oh, no.
Weekends in the day. It's sort of...
Depends on which day, Saturday or Sunday?
Saturday.
It does make sense.
That's not really a problem because the people who enter this competition either don't do parties or thrive on coding.
Well,
immediately after parties and staying up 24 hours. So
non-issue.
So yeah.
Yes.
Grow as small a team as possible, get editors and basically pick them up, go and take them a bit, put them in a corner, and just go and do the thing. Do not involve the rest of the products that could all be on, like, getting help with marketing or something. Just get a small team together and make it happen. If we keep going in circles, we keep trying to plan big things, and year after year, just nothing happens, we just need a small team to go and do something.
That's what I intend to do. The exec will do the details. I'll put a formal call for people who want to be involved on the mailing list, and then everything will be done within that group. Okay?
Yeah.
Any other suggestions or questions before I wind up? With the date, should we leave it to the list or the exec? Leave it to the list?
Yeah.
All right, so dates to be decided, but I'll be posting to the list on that soon. And probably pick one as soon as I can.
Yep.
Thank you for your
excellent.
Input.
All right. Well, that's good because we can probably scratch number 7. Probably won't be needing to discuss number 7 because none of the people that I invited from the other clubs came. Hashan's not here. Yeah, I mean, the interesting project you wanted to do with us. They formulated these managed funds, a statistical algorithm, and they want us to implement it for them.
So they want free work.
Yeah.
No, thanks.
No, we should be more charitable, you know, that sort of thing. Or, collaborate.
Perhaps if members were open to it on a personal basis, not as a club.
Yes. Right.
Yeah, no. We're not a source of free work.
Oh.
Yes.
I don't know, anyway. Yeah, a robotics society, I invited them. I mean, I went down to their basement in level... Yeah, building 2, level 2. Yeah, they have a dungeon on Monday. Yeah, they seem like pretty cool people. They have similar objects to us in a way. And they actually build stuff, you know. They enter robot building competitions and, they like more programmers as well. So, if you'd like to come on down, visit them. They meet every Monday in the basement. I mean, go to utsrobotics.org or something like that. Google them. And Society of Communications, I just invited them because we host their server, we host their website, you know. Yeah. Okay, moving on to number 8, various talks and seminars that we can hold this year.
Yes.
Like, I'd like to make an annual tradition, first year programming fundamentals talk. We should do that sometime very soon, maybe in the next couple of weeks.
And just this time, needs to be a bit better than last year.
Yeah.
I mean, let's just be a bit honest about that. So maybe a couple of slides. I think they all came along wanting hints about their course. And I could tell that, and I was 10 years out of the course, and I could see that that's what they wanted, right? So unless you got some juicy, juicy stuff, you know, they're going to come out disappointed and give a bit of a bad name. So, you know, all of these are a bit more preparation.
Yeah. Which moves me on to the next thing. I mean, you might notice these two gentlemen around the back. They're from a company called Curicon. They're a startup company. And maybe, yes?
I might actually hop that because I've got to get going because I've just got a couple of things I wanted to raise.
Hold on.
Sorry, I've got to get going in a couple of minutes.
Okay.
Just before I get going, I only did a couple of the talks last year that I wanted to. I think I'm banding around to a couple of people talking about the pizza about this. One of the talks I'd like to do is get somebody in from APC around energy use in IT and how, especially having dealt now with Telstra's hosting product and seeing not just Telstra's but other systems integrators, how many data centers are running out of power. What can you just giving an idea to upcoming students, how the systems they should be designing as they come out of uni, can make better, just be more power efficient, use less CPU cycles, better networks, whatever it is, but that we do not live in this infinite bandwidth of power, hungry, power sucking out of the world. So that's one of them. I really want to get some of you from APC. I was thinking about virtualization, how if I got a contact in from VMware, do you think that's still relevant, or is virtualization enough to death, or if so, what would you like to speak about from a virtualization perspective?
I'd like to
hear
about virtualization.
It's a broad topic. Right. It's a hot topic. Everybody's talking about virtualization. Okay, virtualize what? What particularly?
That crosses over with cloud as well. To some extent.
Yeah. For instance, if you want to talk to someone like cloud, I'd get someone in from Fujitsu to talk about domestic cloud, right, as an example of what they're doing for the Department of Defense or some of the big customers, or Telstra hosting. Right? Virtualization, you can do virtualized VMware on Mac with Fusion, you can do VMware on servers, I don't know. So what specifically around virtualization might be a good topic, isn't it?
I'd like to hear technical stuff. When you said it picked up to death, I assume you were talking about
In industry, yeah.
Well, even though it's been under death in the industry, doesn't mean students that had that much exposure to those kind of jobs. So those are the group, or personally, I'd like to hear something more technical, though, depending on what everyone else wants.
So their ideas anybody's got any further thoughts on that? I've just got a couple of other thoughts before I just leave.
Yeah.
Stick to power of energy usage.
Yeah.
Even with them. From the earlier conversation, it sounds like you trailed from power efficiency to virtualization, and I was expecting to stick to. Was that two different talks?
Yeah, two different talks.
Oh, okay, sorry.
Yeah. Somebody from APC, which specifically be talking about power consumption in the industry trends and what they're beginning to see in how to reduce power.
Oh, okay, sorry.
So that's some of the technical ones. Other things I'd like to put out there are a non-technical stream this is kind of brainstorming things like CVs and interviews, taking interviews. There's a lot of that done I acknowledge probably in the business faculty, I can imagine a lot of that being done in other faculties there as well. But going from previous history, technology students have a different challenge when writing up CVs and doing interviews. We specialise in different things, and maybe fronting up in front of a panel of three or four pretty intimidating people for a graduate program isn't one of them. So, yes, I've heard that organising something around career progression might be treading on the toes of being, as an example, or another business society. I say, so what? I say we've still got to be relevant to our crowd, and I think that having something for IT students around career progression.
It's relevant. Well, so I'm sitting on the other side of that table. Our engineers is completely different, and it's relevant to what it was decades ago. The code you haven't got, a public body of work done by, which is something that only applies to codes.
Yeah.
So there's
Yes.
I can safely say that big doesn't really do much except accept their sponsors, so the big companies, so their club members do have exposure to the big companies, but they don't have that extra help to say, how can you make your resume more attractive and get it into the yes file when you actually do get an interview? What kind of questions are they going to ask? How are you going to answer them? Not just wear a suit and walk in, because a lot of people don't know what the recruiters are looking for. On the other hand, the service, the UTS Career Service, is supposed to provide something of that nature. I don't think they're hitting the nail on the head hard enough in regards to the IT students. They're very broad, general, and they apply mostly to the business and engineering students, not so much to the IT crowd. So I think that would be an excellent.
Tina?
Did Chris want to say something as well?
I was just going to say, instead of treading on the toes of the idea, why don't you work with them?
Yeah.
Because they do similar things as well, and I mean, there's no reason we shouldn't combine forces with them now.
Yeah, look at that.
I just want to say that I myself have attended many career fairs and career advisors and etc. And then in 2010, I got an office-setting job. Yeah, I think there can be more work to be done to specialize on IT careers.
Yeah.
You can. Yep.
My three targets would be the HR teams of either Telstra, IBM, or Cisco, because I've worked with quite well with all three of them, and they know me as having my progression from graduate programs and my work over the years. So APC is one talk. That would be another one. No, that'd be the power of the backup company.
Yeah.
UPS.
Yeah.
That's cool. UPS that's power of brand. Any other suggestions?
Throw it on the discussion on the end.
Yeah.
Yep. Okay. Thank you, Deigan.
Thank
you. Oh yes, and now we move on to our gentleman from Curicon over here. I'd like them to speak, introduce themselves a little bit, and tell us what they're all about. You don't mind coming around the front, Matt? Yeah. Or wherever you like.
Oh.
Unfortunately, one of us had to leave. That was Glenn, but I'm Matt, and that's John. And so what's Curicon all about? We are a startup, but unlike many startups, we've done this before. We've been part of successful startups, ones that have failed. We happen to know the right people to raise money from, how to raise money, and we're in the process of raising about $10 million in Silicon Valley at the moment. So we're actually from UTS, all three of us, Glenn, John, and myself. Graduated a few years ago now, but the whole time we were here, we were never part of anything like ProgSoc. And the Computer Society was around then as well. Unfortunately, we didn't have the time because we were actually doing this sort of stuff while we were studying. So as soon as we left school, we sort of went into this. We are web programmers, but I started with traditional C programming, assembly. But the web is where we found ourselves. It's a fun, exciting place to be. Raising money isn't always the easiest thing to do. It's not always easy to get the pre-money valuation that you want. that might not mean anything to you, but Tom has asked me to actually make a speech at some point, or do a talk, what we're all talking about, at some point, where I'll take you through, if anyone's interested, if you guys decide it's a good idea, what pre-money valuations are like, how Series A works, how the whole process works, basically. The fact that Australia is not a very fun place to raise money, because everyone likes to dig rocks out of the ground, and that's all they'll invest in. But fortunately, we have the people that we need to raise money when we need it. This is what's called seed round. And then you've got to pack your bags and go over to California, because that's where all the money is, though New York is up and coming, and we're hopefully meeting some people over there as well. So hopefully we can bring something to ProgSoc that I'm not sure if you've had the opportunity to have this sort of information given to you. I can tell you that startups involve sleeping at the office a lot. Even if you do own property like myself, I sleep at the office and have done since last year because of the startup we're on, which is actually Curicon. We sort of know what we're doing, and hopefully we can give some info. The other thing we are doing is we are recruiting. So we have a Sydney office now, and we will have a Californian office by this time next year. And I'm not necessarily saying anyone that we would recruit could go to California, but I can tell you that what we are doing is pretty exciting, and it's going to be a big deal, and some pretty serious people are backing us on this one. So if anyone fancies themselves as a web programmer, either in the back-end side of things, it is all PHP-based, whether you think that's good or not, it's plenty good for us. So PHP, if you're a front-end designer, I could sure... I'd like to hand over some of my duties, because I am the CEO of the company as well, and that's going to be a long-term thing, so if someone would like to take over my duties in design and front-end programming, I would urge you to put your hand up now, because I'd be excited. But if there's no one here that does that, if you know anyone, we would really like to bring some people on. We actually run an IT management company on the Northern Beaches called ComConnect, and we've employed many UTS students before. If we can continue that tradition and have a more involved relationship with ProgSoc from this point onwards, we would very much like to do that. And if we can bring anything extra to any of these competitions, sort of creating a mini, an incubator has always been something that John and I have wanted to do, and that's our plan once we exit from this this startup, hopefully successfully, so we can actually put that into play. But we've got a lot of ideas and a lot of things we want to actually put forward to ProgSoc, and we want to get involved in a pretty serious way. And we never got that chance when we were here, so we'd like to do it now if we can. So, hopefully you'll see a lot more of us. Hopefully we'll be accepted into your world, and hopefully we can bring in something a little bit different.
Yeah.
And, hopefully it'll be valuable to everyone.
Yeah.
Okay. I didn't actually realise that Tom was going to ask me to speak, so that was because I went a lot.
Yeah.
That's not the way I operate. I've got many hats.
Oh, I don't know. Someone asked you about the talk.
Sorry?
Well, only for ProgSoc, so not anything outside of that.
No.
Could we expand it?
Expand?
To welcome everyone.
Because,
as Deigan said, we really
get
a lot of technical talk, but we haven't really had
anything
like it.
Definitely.
So, I think it would be really
good. Well, like I said, we want to make this an ongoing and growing thing over the years.
Yeah.
While I won't be actually in Australia after about September, October, when we complete the actual raising. In California, it doesn't mean it won't be Florida and Mathletes, and they're still Glenn and John, and we still have an ongoing involvement. There's a lot of different areas that we can explore, definitely. So whatever ideas you guys have, Tom knows how to find us. He's been to our office. He knows that we're real.
Yep. Yeah, I mean, the pertinent question is, when do we want them to speak? Like, what's a good date to have them over for a talk?
Whenever they can.
Whenever.
Yeah.
I mean, they were pushing personally for something a bit more, recent, April, May, this semester.
Yeah.
May's good. Beginning of May, end of May?
Beginning of May.
Beginning of May.
And because end of May is Easter-ish.
Yeah, Easter-ish. Easter is next Friday.
A month after Easter?
Yeah. Yeah.
Because I think the exams start mid June or something.
Right.
Which is exam.
Yeah.
The entire, well, no, I mean, not all students are going to have the entire exam occupied for. But we don't, we, like, we don't know what the exam schedule is going to be until
May.
They're
doing on the 11th of June,
yeah.
Starting that date.
Mm.
The
people
in May,
yeah.
Should be
yeah.
Okay.
Middle of May.
We still have to worry that the end of May is the outside of rush period.
And then we need a day of the week where the whole of the IT class isn't
right.
Like,
okay. I'm guessing we can't really decide the date right now in
yeah.
Concrete.
We don't have a consolidated time period.
Yeah.
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 Oh,
well,
me and her.
Do you want to do this?
I guess.
Yeah.
So do you want to go?
I'll take mine that I'm
always
allocated.
Oh, okay.
Give it away.
I'm the primary liaison.
Okay,
yeah.
So can we leave?
Sure.
Yeah.
Week or
right.
Without, you know,
okay.
So we don't
sorry? Yeah.
Oh, he's got the key.
Okay, good. Yeah, we'll take you up to the dean's unit whenever, like, just let me know. You got my email.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Once
you've
got that, yeah. So, okay. Okay, okay. All right, then. I mean, okay, we haven't set a date yet. Tentative mid-May. We should probably discuss this a bit more in private. Thorworks we probably should do something with them, get in touch with them again, see what we can do. We had some wonderful talk on Agile, as I said, and a wonderful Lego activity. Who knows what we can do next with them. Yeah. Moving on to other more fun diversions. Christmas party. I know, it's a bit early, but let's think about this now, because... I mean,
now?
Yeah, now.
9:25.
I'll just say the day before Christmas Eve, like, work let me out at lunchtime, and I went home early.
Yeah.
So maybe not so.
Okay, but here's the thing. It was our visit to the Star was kind of short notice. We didn't really think of something until like the week before. So, and like we came up with all these wonderful, awesome ideas, like. Or was it Segways with laser tag on Cockatoo Island or some crazy thing?
Segways are freaking
amazing. Yeah, we're freaking laser beams.
I think the consensus was that most people finish exams by the first week of December.
Yeah.
So, I mean, we should try and have as early as possible after exams.
Both people are on the way.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Proposal. Although this meeting is reserved for example, the council at the end, I believe we don't move so slowly that we
don't have to. It's not so much planning with Soar, just bringing up the idea. I mean,
exactly.
There shall be parties.
Excellent.